गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल. आई डॉक्टर सपना अहलावत प्रेजेंट अ पेपर ऑन द स्पेक्ट्रम ऑफ इमेजिंग फाइंडिंग इन द ब्रेकियल फ्लेक्सस इंजरी अंडर द गाइडेंस ऑफ डॉक्टर अलका अग्रवाल मैम, हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रेडियो डायग्नोसिस एमजीएम एमवाई मेडिकल कॉलेज इंदौर. सी द ब्रेकियल फ्लेक्सस इंजरी द मोस्ट कॉमन कॉज इज द ट्रॉमा एंड द क्लिनिकल इन्वेस्टिगेशन फॉर द पेरिफेरल नर्व इंजरी रूटीनली इंक्लूड द नर्व कंडक्शन स्टडी एंड इलेक्ट्रोमायोग्राफी एंड द इमेजिंग स्टडी इज लिमिटेड टू एक्सटेंडिंग फोकल मास लीजन एंड एक्सटर्नल कंप्रेशन. एमआरआई आइडेंटिफाई चेंजेस इन द पेरिफेरल नर्व सेकेंडरी न्यूरोजेनिक ऑल्टरेशन इन द स्केलेटल मसल. एमआरआई इज ऑल्सो हेल्पफुल इन डायग्नोसिंग लोकलाइजिंग द साइट ऑफ इंजरी ऑन विच द प्रोग्नोसिस डिपेंड. And the contrast study is usually done in patient with tumor or mass lesion. Gadolinium is not administered in patient with traumatic brachial plexopathy. Here you can see in the schematic diagram, the nerve fiber are torn due to stretching of the stretching between the neck and the shoulder. Here nerve fiber torn due to outstretching of the hand. Now let's discuss the categorization of the nerve injury plexopathy. See the first degree neuropraxia. Here you can see only impaired nerve conduction with intact axon and the connective tissue layers. In the second degree, axonal disruption with intact endo, epi and perineurium. Third degree include the axonal and endoneural disruption with intact perineurium and epineurium. Fourth degree include the axonal, endo and perineurial disruption with intact only epineurium. In the fifth degree, complete nerve disruption. If there is any combination, then it will come under the sixth degree. Here you can see in this schematic diagram, in the first, you can see the preganglionic fiber tears where the surgical repair impossible. In the second, postganglionic tear, here surgical repair possible. In the third, axonotmesis, and then the neuropraxia. Let's discuss if there is which nerve fibers are routinely affected in case of any lesion. If the lesion is supraclavicular, then the C5, 6, 7, C8 and T1 roots are mainly involved. Phrenic nerve, long thoracic nerve, trunk mein upper, middle and lower trunks are involved. Nerve to the subclavius or suprascapular nerve. If there is any clavicular lesion, then division of upper, middle or lower trunk include. Then infraclavicular lesion cases, they involve lateral cord and its terminal branches like lateral pectoral nerve, medial pectoral nerve, lateral rotomedial nerve and the median cord and ulnar nerve, posterior cord and its branches. Then let's discuss technique and sequence. We use mainly 1.5 Tesla and 3 Tesla MRI for optimal imaging. Specialized RF receiver coil are used, surface coil or phased array coil, which provide high signal to noise ratio with a small field of view. And the protocol mainly we use T1 weighted sequence in the coronal sas and axial, shows detailed anatomy and is used to define the bony structure and tissue planes surrounding the nerve. T2 weighted sequence and the STIR sequence in the coronal, sagittal, axial images provide uniform and reliable fat suppression over the curved surface and large field of view. And the post-contrast T1 fat set sequences in case of neoplasm infection and polyneuropathies. Then let's discuss preganglionic brachial plexopathy first. Common finding, here we get the edema of the spinal cord, hemorrhage in the nerve root on GRE and the pseudomeningocele, and preganglionic injury usually have poor prognosis. See, ideally imaging of suspected preganglionic injury is performed at least 3 to 4 weeks after the injury, as this allows the resolution of acute edema and subarachnoid hemorrhage and formation of pseudomeningocele. Then let's discuss few cases of the preganglionic injury. Case 1, patient present with the symptom of right-sided partial ptosis and meiosis, likely clinical diagnosis, Horner syndrome. There was history of 6-month back trauma history. Here you can see pseudomeningocele formation noted at the C7, C8, T1 at the level of neural foramina, suggestive of preganglionic nerve root avulsion injury. Then another case, a 6-year-old child present with weakness in the left hand side, since birth with poor reflexes, sensory loss, mild stiffness, joint and muscle weakness and atrophy, claw hand and fingers. There was history of assisted delivery at local PHC. Nerve conduction study showed deficit in the motor function along the ulnar nerve distribution. Here you can see वेल डिफाइंड डंबल शेप सिस्टिक लीजन इन द लेफ्ट C7 and T1 एंड लेफ्ट T1 T2 न्यूरल फोरामेन विच इज एक्स्ट्रा ड्यूरल एंड एक्सटेंड जस्ट बियॉन्ड द न्यूरल फोरामेन. द राइट C8 and T1 नर्व रूट आर नॉट विजुअलाइज सजेस्टिव ऑफ सूडो मेनिंगोसील एंड प्री गैंग्लियोनिक ब्रेकियल प्लेक्सस इंजरी. लेट्स डिस्कस पोस्ट गैंग्लियोनिक इंजरी. हेयर द नर्व रूट्स यूजुअली सीन एट द ओरिजिन नॉर्मल एंड द थिकनिंग ऑफ T2 हाइपर इंटेंसिटी ऑफ द नर्व रूट ट्रंक कॉर्ड एंड एसोसिएटेड एडिमा. एसोसिएटेड फाइंडिंग यू कैन गेट क्लेविकुलर फ्रैक्चर और एडजेसेंट नियोप्लाज्म. लेट्स डिस्कस फ्यू केसेस. Here the patient present with history of trauma followed by weakness in the right upper limb. In the MRI, you can see the T2 stress hyperintensity is noted in the upper trunk of brachial plexus, suggestive of axonotmesis, that is grade 3 injury of the upper trunk of brachial plexus. Another case, invasive ductal carcinoma in a 51-year-old woman who had undergone radiation therapy to the axilla. Neurological damage after radiation therapy may be observed several months to years after therapy, and it is most likely to occur in patients who have received radiation dose in excess of 60 gyrel. Here you can see diffuse thickening of the cord of bilateral brachial plexus suggestive of post-radiation plexopathy. See, the most common DD of the radiation plexopathy is the tumor recurrence. How we can differentiate both these? See, the radiation plexopathy, usually we get few months to 20 years, especially dose exceeding 60 grays. Usually involve the infraclavicular plexus, and on the EMG, we can get the myoclonic discharges in the 30% cases. On MRI, diffuse uniform symmetrical swelling and the bright T2 signal within the radiation field and mild post-contrast enhancement. In the tumor recurrence cases, usually it would occur within 1 year after the treatment, and the lower supraclavicular plexus, especially C8, T1 and lower trunk involved. On EMG, we get no changes, and the MRI, we get on MRI non-uniform asymmetric focal enlargement with focal enhancing mass lesion. On the let's discuss few non-traumatic brachial plexopathies. Here you can see the patient known case of CA lung with symptom of neural deficit in the right upper limb. MRI was performed, and here you can get the soft tissue mass in the right lung apex, soft tissue mass in the right lung apex, and extension of this mass into the C7D1 and D1D2 neural vertebral foramen, invasion and encasement of the subclavian and right vertebral artery, and lower trunk of the right brachial plexus, finding suggestive of the Pancoast tumor. Another case, patient present with left neck mass lesion associated with symptom of neural deficit. Here, MRI was performed, a well-defined peripherally enhancing lesion showing multiple thin internal septation in the left supra and infraclavicular, located along the cord and division of left brachial plexus, showing T2 and flare hyper intense signal suggestive of neural edema and closely abutting the subclavian vessels. Another case, known case of CA breast present with symptom of neural deficit in the left upper limb. MRI was performed. Here you can get multiple confluent T2 and stir hyper intense soft tissue deposits seen along the trunk and division of left brachial plexus, with epicenter of this lesion is seen in the interscalenic triangle. The lesion shows significant enhancement on post-contrast study, with continuous contrast enhancement noted along the thickened root of left brachial plexus and encroaches the cord of brachial plexus in the axillary fossa. Now let's come on the conclusion part. See, MRI is an invaluable modality for characterization of the brachial plexus lesion, and the optimal technique planning is essential for adequate visualization. Their complex imaging anatomy can be simplified by using easily identifiable anatomic landmark. These are my few references. Thank you.